Good morning. For those of you who do not know me, my name is Susan Caravello, and I am a member of the Worship Committee. And I am here today to help be an assistant to our guest minister, whom I will introduce later on. It is my pleasure to welcome you to Shelter Rock. If you are new or visiting us today for the first time, we're very glad you're here. And if you'd like more information about Unitarian Universalism and this congregation, we invite you to complete one of the blue visitor information cards, which you can find either in the rack in the pew or out at the membership desk. Immediately after service this morning, we will reconvene in the social hall just across the lobby for our UU Cafe, where lunch can be purchased for a reasonable sum. If you are joining us for the first time, we hope that you will allow us to treat you to lunch. Please stop by the welcome desk in the lobby to receive your yellow guest ticket. But if you don't have time for lunch today, we hope you will at least be able to stay a while for coffee and conversation. In your order of service, you will find a calendar and many announcements of activities and programs. We hope you'll take the time to read them through and that you will feel invited to attend all the events you find listed there. And I was given one announcement to read for today. This week's RE summer program, Arts and Nature at the Rock, is in room 15 during service. All children kindergarten through six are welcome. Today, the children will be taking a nature walk and constructing fairy houses, whatever they are. Today's program will go until 12:15. Come and join us. Okay, at this time, we're going to have a greet your neighbors, so if you will all get up, shake hands, and say hey. I received several other announcements. It is my unhappiness to report that Ed Simmons, a longtime member of this congregation, passed away on Friday. He was at his daughter's home down in Florida. There will be a memorial service later, but we don't have the details at this time. And second, we have an art announcement. They are collecting art from the congregation. If you could have it here by Thursday, the setup will be on Friday, and the reception will be on Sunday, the welcome. All right, I think that's the end of our introductions. going to have the candlelight, the chalice lighting at this time. Give up? I just gotta find it. Yeah. Pardon me? Oh, yes. Prelude, go for it. In the meantime, I'll find my thing. At this time, I'm going to introduce our visiting minister, the Reverend Adrienne Hausch. She's a lifelong Long Island resident, having gone through the Mineola public school system. In addition to being an ordained minister, she holds a BA from Hofstra, MBA from LIU, and a JD, whatever that is, from St. John's Law School. Reverend Hausch has taught for many years at New York Tech and St. Vincent's College at St. Vincent University. Following her MDIV from Brunswick, all these things are confusing me, Theological Seminary in 1995, she became assistant pastor for the Community Church of Douglaston until 2014. She served on the Board of Trustees of the seminary from 2000 to 2007. In addition to her ministerial activities, the Reverend Hausch has been very actively involved in the Nassau County Bar Association. She ran for state office assembly in 1980 and has been a member of the Committee on Character and Fitness. We could use all of that. Appellate Division, Second Department since 1999. She currently lives in Garden City. She loves opera and has had season tickets to the Metropolitan Opera since the age of 16. So we'll welcome our visiting minister, Dr. Adrienne Rausch.
The JD stands for Juris Doctor, and that's where I get the doctor designation. Although in the United States, it's not considered, it's de rigueur to refer to lawyers as doctors. Our opening words today come from a Psalm of David, chapter 85, verses 8 through 13. Let me hear what God the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace to his people, to his saints, to those who turn to him in their hearts. Surely his salvation is at hand for those who fear him, that glory may dwell in our land. Steadfast love and faithfulness will meet, righteousness and peace will kiss each other. Faithfulness will spring up from the ground, and righteousness will look down from the sky. Yea, the Lord will give what is good, and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness will go before him and make his footsteps a way.
At this time, we will have our chalice lighting. We hallow this time together by lighting the flame of our chalice, symbol of Unitarian Universalist tradition. Will you rise and join us in singing hymn number 124, Be That Guide. Remain standing, and we will say together the words of affirmation and the song of affirmation. Love is the doctrine of this congregation. The quest of truth is its sacrament, and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge and freedom, to serve human need, this do we affirm and covenant with each other. If you're grateful for the presence of Unitarian Universalism in this world and for this congregation, become its advocate. If you are concerned for the future of our faith, share our message. If our principles resonate deep within you, give to this religious tradition your devotion. Our tradition of Unitarian Universalism cannot survive without your devotion and your generosity. Would the ushers please come forward to accept this morning's offering?
scriptures this morning. And you'll hear about them again. First, from the first book of Kings, chapter 19, verses 9 through 18. And then Elijah came to a cave and lodged there. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And Elijah said, "I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken the covenant, thrown down thy altars, and slain thy prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away." And he said, "Go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord." And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind rent the mountains and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still small voice. And then Elijah heard it. He wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. And behold, there came a voice to him and said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And he said, "I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thy altars, and slain thy prophets with the sword, and I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away." And the Lord said to him, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael to be king over Syria, and Jehu, the son of Nimshi, you shall anoint to be king over Israel, and Elisha, the son of Shaphat, of Abel-Meholah, you shall anoint to be prophet in your place. And him who escapes from the sword of Hazael shall Jehu slay, and him who escapes from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, all the knees that have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him." So he departed from there and found Elisha, the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen before him. And he said with the 12th, "Elijah passed by him and cast his mantle upon him." And from the letter of Paul to the Romans, we hear, Moses writes that the man who practices the righteousness which is based on the law shall live by it. But the righteousness based on faith says, "Do not say in your heart, 'Who will ascend into heaven?' that is, to bring Christ down, or 'Who will descend into the abyss?' that is, to bring Christ up from the dead." But what does it say? "The word is near you on your lips and in your heart," that is, the word of faith which we preach. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For man believes with his heart and so is justified, and he confesses with his lips and so is saved. The scripture says, "No one who believes in him will be put to shame, for there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and bestows his riches upon all who call upon him. For everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. But how are men to call upon in him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without a preacher? And how can men preach unless they are sent? As it is written, 'How beautiful are the feet of those who preach good news.'"
At this time, we will have the candle lighting. I invite any who would like to light candles of joy or sorrow to come forward now in the quiet of this moment as all of us join in silence, focusing our intentions on these candles of celebration and concern.
Come together this day, help us to find our voice as we listen to the voices of those who seek freedom from oppression, who seek lasting justice and peace. Free us from fear and hatred, from suspicion and prejudice, that we may come to see all persons as our brothers and sisters. We are people of privilege, and even the poorest of the poor in this country are wealthier than the wealthy in many others. May we have generous hearts that we might give beyond what is expected and give what is needed. Bring wisdom to the leaders of this nation and other nations who think that war and violence are the answers to hostility and conflict. As one man has said, the bugle of arms is easier to hear than the wistful solo voice of peace. Our voices are silent, but our hearts cry out, hear us now. May love, peace, and justice always prevail. Knowing a little bit about Unitarian beliefs, I thought the scriptures I chose and the message, the theme of this message, meshed well with one of the principles of this congregation that pledges that you are open to all ideas. I am what is called a minister of word and sacrament.
We'll get started into it, we got a solo first.
Sorry!
Thank you.
wasn't there, Blythe, where it said solo. So when Nathaniel started to play, I go, gee, that doesn't sound like Vaughan Williams, but what do I know? All right, so let me start again. Hi, I'm Adrian. And knowing a little bit about the Unitarian Church, I thought that the scriptures I chose and the theme of this message meshed well with one of the principles of this congregation that pledges that you are open to all ideas. So here you are, and that lady over there promised she would not throw rotten tomatoes. So she'll stop you if you get in there. Okay, so I am what is called a minister of word and sacrament in the Reformed Church in America, which nobody's ever heard of, but it used to be the Dutch Reformed Church. Yet I do not accept every principle of that denomination. And I must admit, that denomination and many others are struggling with what they believe and what they do not, what is correct and what is not. So my rebellious nature can accept the idea of and the need for diversity in our beliefs, so long as we respect and honor the beliefs of others. That is not to say that I do not think that many who profess to be speaking the truth are not. In my other life as an attorney, the definition of truth is as murky today as it was when a guy in Israel advised that God had given him the truth in a set of principles that we call the Ten Commandments. We each have our own truth. I happen to like mine. And I believe that my way of thinking has great merit. As a Christian pastor, I rely often for my weekly inspiration on a spiritual reference guide called the Common Lectionary. It is a resource used by many Christian clergy. So when I was invited to speak here today, I took a look at the lectionary. And there it was. God told Elijah to listen to that still small voice, and Paul tells the Romans to cut out the nonsense and listen to his loud one. I really think the guys who compose the lectionary get a lot of laughs out of the juxtaposition of the thoughts they suggest we ponder. And I could not help but think of my friends in the Unitarian tradition who speak often of relying on what? Instinct, the higher power, their intellect, the fulfillment of their goals of respect for others, justice for all, and compassion in times of trouble. When I was a little girl, my grandfather, Poppy, he told me, listen to your conscience, it is God speaking to you. Poppy explained that we were never alone. We always had that still, small voice that spoke to us and helped us to make the right decisions. And I know where we got those words. I cannot help but believe that I am not alone. The Reformed Church has a catechism, the first question of which is, what is my only comfort in life and in death? And the answer is that I am not alone, but belong body and soul to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. And he's mine. He's my guy. And I know that I am not alone, sometimes in big ways, sometimes in small. A number of years ago, I was stopped at a light on the Expressway Service Road, eastbound, about to cross Glen Cove Road. You know where it is, up the hill, right? The light turned green. I didn't move. The horn started honking. I just could not move. All of a sudden, this huge 18-wheeler with a great big trailer comes plowing through the intersection. Had I gone, I wouldn't be standing here today. Something told me not to go. That still small voice saved my life that day. A couple of days ago, I made a stir fry for dinner. I sat down in the dining room to eat and decided it needed more kick, so I got up and went into the kitchen to get some hot sauce. The lights were out and I saw the burner was on under the frying pan. Coincidence? A real silly one. I was recording a deposit from the bank for my law firm, and I was $100 short. Whose check was that? Rats. Some poor person was not going to get credit for a payment. So I went back to my desk and I went to work and I grabbed a piece of scrap paper off the pile behind me. I'm Dutch, I never waste anything. So if I get a draft of a document or something and it's old, I just stuff it in the corner and use it over again as scrap paper. So anyway, I pulled out a piece of paper and it was a draft of a document with a name on it. Yep, the name of the person who had given me the $100. That's right, it was her check. Thanks again, as always. I was a lawyer for 12 years before I started seminary, and after 8 years of study, I graduated with my MDiv, Master of Divinity, and was ordained. When I decided to go to seminary, I asked my secretary, my legal secretary, if she would be so kind as to order my transcripts from my college and graduate schools. She said, "You're going to seminary, aren't you?" I go, "How did you know?" "Oh, I've known it for years." I go, "Well, why didn't you tell me?" I go, "Well, you know, that's because it's something you have to figure out on your own." I rather wish that still small voice had shouted a bit louder then. I really was too old for all that studying. But it was a great time, and I learned a lot. And I learned where my center was. And I learned who and what I loved. And I learned that maybe, just maybe, we and that voice are not always speaking the same language. Silly example, okay? There's this farmer, and he's plowing the fields, and he's digging, and he grows nothing but rocks and weeds. Nothing comes up. So one day he's out there, and he's working away, and he's sweating, and he looks up, and there's this huge, the clouds are forming and swirling, and they write P-C. And he says, "I get it. I'm supposed to preach Christianity." So he goes out, he gets himself a little collar, he's going from place to place to place, and they keep throwing rocks at him and those old tomatoes, and they can't handle it. One day he dies, and he goes up to the pearly gates, and he meets St. Peter, and I see someone smiling, you know the punchline of this story. Okay, he sees St. Peter, and he says, "St. Peter, why, oh why? I was such a failure as a farmer, I was such a failure as a preacher. Why didn't you give me some guidance?" He goes, "I did. I wanted you to plant corn." I know, it's a real groaner. Here's one that's a little bit better. Okay. All right. There's this man, this big flood. We've heard about him now. And he's in his house. He's in his house. I can't wander. Okay, I got it. He's in his house, and the flood waters start to come up. Okay? And he goes to the second floor, and this guy in a boat comes by and says, "I'll take you out of your house and I'll save you." And he goes, no, "The Lord will provide." And then the water gets deeper, and he goes up on the roof, and the Coast Guard comes by with this big ship, and he says, come, get on the boat. I'll save you. We'll save you." And he says, no, "The Lord will provide." And now he's climbing up the chimney, and he's holding on, and a helicopter comes by and drops a rope and says, "Grab the rope, I'll take you away." He goes, no, "The Lord will provide." He goes into the water, he drowns. And when he meets St. Peter, he says, "Why didn't you save me?" He goes, "I sent 2 boats and a helicopter." That one's a little better, right? I love people, and I envy people who make decisions and are able to analyze the consequences of their actions. In psychology, it's called risk analysis. Our gut tells us if the rewards will outweigh the negative consequences, we will go forward. Experimental medication and its side effects. Financial losses for certain business decisions. Marrying the one mom loathes. Going to Hofstra instead of Harvard. Actually, it was Northeastern that I picked Hofstra over. Stopping at the intersection even though the light is green. Throughout our lives, we make thousands of decisions, some seeming to have no consequences whatsoever. I'm like, who would think that eating at Chipotle would land you in the hospital? or that taking a back road to avoid a traffic jam would result in you saving a man who was stuck in a burning car. Did you read that one a few weeks ago in the paper? Or that 20 years later, someone would come up to you and say, you know, your words changed my life. I gotta tell you, I've been blessed by that one. Human beings were not meant to survive on their own. We do have self-contained communities, but those hermits who run off and live in caves in the desert are not what we as humans were designed to be. And even when Elijah went off to the cave, he came back again. Because we are social animals and we live in herds. I mean, just ride the subway at rush hour, right? Really, those who live in physical isolation suffer physical ailments, mental illness, and all sorts of other ills. We need to rely on one another. Congregation. It's a great word. I was a chemistry major. We used to us, it used to mean a bunch of protozoa. We always talked about a congregation of protozoa. An assemblage, a gathering, a flock, a bunch of people getting together for a common goal, support, acceptance, love, caring. Elijah was told that he would never be alone. That voice would always be there to guide him. Elijah knew that that voice to be the voice, he knew to him that was the voice of God. I know that many of you, for many of you, it's a different voice. Fine. Maybe I'm here to proselytize, maybe I'm not. Maybe you'll come around, no pressure. Paul found his voice. And I found my voice too. And I'm glad that I did. And that discovery made a difference in my life. I had actually typed in to say, I still do lots of things that I shouldn't, but I feel bad about it. And then I said, no, that's what delete, delete, delete is for. Thank you for that button. But truly, you are here today. Is that because you have found how to be perfect? Or is that because you are struggling to find the right road? Is that because you feel good when you see all these great people? Is that because you hear that voice but cannot figure out whose it is? Paul was an apostle of Jesus. Paul believed Jesus to be one sent by God for our salvation. Clearly, the text I read says that. It tells us how to take advantage of that gift. I often tell my Jewish friends that our faith and beliefs are exactly the same, except for one teeny-weeny little different. They believe that Jesus was a well-spoken carpenter from Nazareth, and I believe he was the Son of God. Other than that, we're just the same. I found my path. I heard that voice. My presence here today is my witness to your continued search. I appreciate you listening to my perspective. I appreciate your faith, your respect for my faith, for my comfort, and for my small voice. May you hear that small voice also. May your life always be guided by the spirit of truth and love and compassion. May the universal in your name allow you to continue down the road to the one that is truly the least taken. When I saw this, I thought of Robert Frost. When given my option, I take the road least taken, the one of respect, the one of trusting in the worth of every human being. Yesterday I attended the centennial celebration of Camp Mills, which was the home to the Rainbow Division, the 42nd Infantry. Since I literally live on top of Camp Mills, I kind of figured I had to go. 200,000 men went through that camp before debarking for France in World War I. 16,000 never returned. Actually, that's a pretty low percentage in those days. 16,000 men who never saw their wives or children again. 16,000 men whose contributions to our world never went further than a battlefield 3,000 miles from home. Actually, as much as 6,000 miles, since they came from 26 different US states. I could not help but remember John Donne's poem written for another war hundreds of years before. No man is an island entire of itself. Every man's death, sorry, I always lose it. Every man's death diminishes me because I am involved in mankind and therefore never sent to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee. May a still, small voice always be with you today and forever. Let us bow our heads. I thank the voice that comes to me, and I pray that for all of us here today, that voice comes to help us and to guide us and allow us to be the people that we should be, that we want to be, that we try to be. For all these things, we thank you. Amen.
If you'll join me in singing the closing hymn, number 168, One More Step.
Into the world, may joy, peace, and love abide. May your love for one another keep you until we meet again. Amen.